verses 4 through 8 of the chapter that we are working our way through. We actually covered verse 4 last week, but it does sort of introduce us to what's going to follow, so it will only be a passing glance as we look at that one. We want to look then at Acts chapter 8, verses 4 through 8, but most especially verse 8. As I was studying it, this verse was very much laid on my heart as being what should be the theme for this morning as we gather together. And there was great joy in that city. And there was great joy in that city. It's a very little word, but it has a great wealth of meaning, does it not? What is joy? A dictionary I looked up says the emotion evoked by well-being, success, or good fortune, or by the prospect of possessing what one desires. That's joy. The emotion evoked by well-being, success, or good fortune, or by the prospect of possessing what one desires. Well, that's how the world describes joy. It's a subject they're always talking about. When you speak with people, somewhere in the conversation will come up something like, did you enjoy it? Whether that was going to church, whether that was watching sports or participating in some other activity, the great test of whether something is good or bad in modern language is, did you enjoy it? Or are you enjoying it? Some folks even apply it to sermons, etc. Let me tell you, you'll not always enjoy sermons. Sometimes they have to say very firm things. But when the gospel went to this city of Samaria, it had a profoundly transforming effect. It's just a few words, but I pray that they might be burned into your mind and that they might become your great desire. And there was great joy in that city. Great joy in that city. Joy, you see, is constantly attached to knowing God, to experiencing His grace, and to be at rest in His great love and favor towards us. You find it all over the Old Testament. Psalm 32:11 instructs us, in fact, it commands us, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous, and shout for joy, O you upright in heart. I wonder when you were last shouting for joy about God's grace and mercy. Psalm 98, verse 4, shout joyfully to the Lord, O the earth. Break forth in song, rejoice and sing praises. Something happened in the city of Samaria that gave them reason to break forth. They weren't beaten about the ears with a command to have joy or rejoice. What they did, as I will hope to show you, is they experienced the wonder of God's gracious love and His great mercy in giving His Son to be the Saviour of the world. I've got three subheadings for you this morning. A time of great joy. I'm going to look at joy itself. And then we're going to see that that joy came from hearing Jesus is Christ. And then lastly, that joy came through the lips of a preacher. So in actual fact, what I'm going to do is start with verse 8 and then work backwards through the passage so that we get the reasons for this great conclusion. A time of great joy. I love this. And there was great joy in that city. What is joy? Somebody helpfully explained that joy is Jesus and you, that's the first letter and the last letter, with nothing in between. Jesus and you with nothing in between. And I put it to you, that's what the people in this city of Samaria are experiencing, and that's why there is great joy in the city. They have a sense of gladness. because of God's great love in sending his Son as their Saviour. Now stop and think, this is what everybody's actually looking for. When the Bible says God has set eternity in men's hearts, what they're looking for is joy, and so what they do is they rush off in various pursuits. Nothing wrong with sports, but you can go to a sports match and everybody roars and sings. It's apparently the only other place where people sing like they do in church. In fact, more people sing at football matches than they do in church, or rugby matches. Or you might find your joy in finding something beautiful and studying or creating it. Joy, you see, is the pursuit of mankind. And I need to ask you, as I ask myself, if there was such a thing as a joyometer, what would you be reading this morning? Where would you be on the scale? It's chilly in here, 10 degrees. It's usually up about 15 and maybe even 20 in the summer. Are you like the seasons that come and go? Or does joy play a significant part in your life? Because you can have joy, which is different from happiness. It's always useful to point out the difference. Happiness depends on what's happening. Joy is that awareness of God's love for you and for me. You see, and to notice in this passage that the joy is not simply that of one individual. This joy pervades the whole city. What's another word to describe that? It's very simple, it's called revival. It's where the word of God has taken such an effect that not just one or two have become believers, but that the vast majority of the citizens of the city have become believers. Remember those words from Psalm 98 verse 4, shout joyfully to the Lord. But then it says, all the earth. And in David's writing back then, he's not simply saying, I'm rejoicing in God. He's looking forward to that day which is promised in the scripture, when Christ shall reign from shore to shore, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, and where there will be constant joy. It was clearly a major factor in the New Testament church, and historically it has been a major factor in the spread of Christianity when people are taken up with the wonder of God's love. It doesn't matter what the world does to them, because then joy breaks forth. Acts 13 has this account in verse 50. When the Jews stirred up the devout and prominent women and the chief men of the city, raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and came to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. You see, a joyometer would be a very useful tool, wouldn't it? If you had to press your forefinger on it as you came in to the chapel on a Sunday morning to see not what your blood pressure is, not what your pulse is, but whether in fact the wonder of God's love is operating and functioning in your life, so that wherever you are, again, it's not something you simply to work up. It is something that God gives. John 15:11, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you. My joy. And that your joy may be full. See how they go together? When you understand the one who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, that's my joy, isn't it? His delight was dying for your salvation and for mine. And when you know that you've responded to that call of the great shepherd, and boy, there's something got to be on fire in your life. I read this extended illustration and I want to introduce it at this point. Apparently, on one occasion, Martin Luther had been brooding for several days. There was so much trouble going on, and there was reports of the peasants' revolt, papal pressure, and the nobles were opposed to him, and that he began to think what he was involved with was a hopeless task. On the morning when he was at his deepest darkness, he came into the dining room for breakfast, and his wife, whose name was Katie, greeted him attired in a black dress, as if she was going to a funeral. So he looked at her and greeted her apparently with his usual Guten Morgen, Herr Doktor. But this morning she never said a word to him. "What is wrong, Katie?" Martin inquired. "God is dead," she announced sadly. "God? Woman, that is a terrible heresy," he replied. "God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. Never say that the eternal has died. When heaven and earth pass away, God will remain." "Then why do you waken each morning with such a doleful expression on your face? Why do you go through the day sighing like the north wind? In your university class, you claim to interpret the mind of God. You have appeared to know him very well, and I became certain from the expression on your face that God must surely have expired." Suddenly, Martin Luther burst out laughing. "You have convinced me, Katie, dear," he said. "So if ever you see me again with a melancholy countenance, remind me that God is living, that he will live forever. I promise you that I shall try not to appear as dour as a shriveled turnip." That's a picture to grasp, isn't it? I fear I could be guilty of being as dour as a shriveled turnip. And the reason it happens is, dear friend, we lose sight of the fact not only that God is alive, but that God died on the cross for our sins and rose again the third day and is alive for, you know the next word? That has to be powerful in our lives. That has to be a reason for joy. A joy that's different to the joy of the unbeliever. And the Bible is quite plain. Unbelievers experience joy, even if it's only in spurts and little bits. Job chapter 20, verse 5. "The triumphing of the wicked is short, and the joy of the hypocrite is but for a moment." So that and many other verses would show us that the unbeliever can have something of this experience. But if you read your Bible, it's most especially the experience of God's people. Because we are constantly reminded of his love, care, and grace for us. Proverbs 5:18, there is to be joy in being married. Psalm 113, verse 9, there is to be joy in the birth of children. Deuteronomy 26, 1 and following, there's to be joy in the harvest. Ecclesiastes 8:15, there's to be joy in the feasting. You see, God has given us a world which is beautiful and good for us. And just in the experiencing of that, there is a kind of joy. Deuteronomy 26, 11 says, "So you shall rejoice in every good thing which the Lord your God has given you and your house, you and the Levite and the stranger who is among you." Israel were commanded to experience joy in the awareness that God had given them everything that they were experiencing. In case you think it's only the Old Testament, 1 Timothy 6:17, "Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God," and here's the phrase we want, "who gives us richly all things to enjoy." You see, joy is to be part of our lives. But what we're looking at in this passage is a specific and very clear kind of joy. It is called great joy. It's interesting to see that word great there. Run your eye back to verse 1 of the chapter. "At that time there was great persecution." You would understand what that means. It means intense. It means hard. It means that living life was tough. There was great persecution. Read on, and devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation. It's almost as if Luke, as he's writing, has included that word great specifically to prepare you for verse 8. Because you clearly understand that great persecution means that there's something intense going on. Great lamentation. You can see all these Jewish men tearing their shirts open, throwing dirt on their hair and crying, "Whoa!" It's not something that would be like a wee quiet mouse in the corner, is it? And there was great joy in that city. There was great joy in that city. That's the challenge I find here in the passage. John Calvin writes about this. He says, "The joy whereof he speaketh is a fruit of faith. For it cannot be but that so soon as we know that God will be favourable and merciful, our minds shall be wrapped with incomparable joy. As soon as we know that God will be favourable and merciful, as soon as we realise that our sins are forgiven." I know it's a tough concept. I've been wrestling with it since Wednesday. And I'm a dour Scotsman by nature. We invented gloomy. But my Bible tells me that even in my temperament, there should be this constant quality, because it is a quality and not just an emotion, a quality of life which is grounded in God and derived from Him. Psalm 16:11, "In your presence is fullness of joy." Jesus and you with nothing in between, a living relationship, because your sin which separated you from God has been taken away by His death on the cross, and now we come boldly to the throne of grace. We enter into the Father's presence, and if that's not exciting, something has gone amiss. A little verse in 1 Peter I read. Let me just get the exact words, I've not written it down. 1 Peter 1:8. It's just incredible when you begin studying the theme, how verses suddenly speak to you that you've not noticed before. Verse 7, "Though the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honour and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, who, having not seen..." Love. This is a key to joy. "Whom having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him," he's not visible, "yet believing," that's living by faith, "you rejoice with joy inexpressible." That's great joy, isn't it? "You rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory." You can't get the words to explain it. And so, dear friends, we need to be men and women who are serious about being joyful. That's not a complete contradiction. It doesn't mean you've got to suddenly become hands in the air, skipping and dancing all the time. That's more like happiness when it happens. But there is to be burning in our bosom a real delight in God's gracious favour and mercy. I would suggest to you it's one of the marks of really knowing God. The fruit of the Spirit is love. You know the next word, don't you? Joy. Peace. When you know you're loved, it transforms who you are. We see it in society. We worry about children who are not brought up in a safe, loving home, because we know that it distorts their personality. And so when you know that God loved not just the world but me, then, dear friend, you're liberated. So real joy is not something that's stirred by a song. It's not even something which is going to be specifically stirred by a sermon. It has to be the overflow and the outflow of the heart. The well of water Jesus spoke about, springing up into everlasting life. George Whitfield was converted. Apparently the dear man cried out, "Joy! Joy unspeakable! Joy that's full of and big with glory." You remember when you were converted? For some it was a gentle experience, not dramatic. But somewhere in those days after you became to Christ, there was a freshness of the wonder and the marvels of God's mercy. That's what the unbeliever's looking for. That's what was filling this city. How did it come to fill the city? Well, it's quite clear if you just step back a little bit from where we are. Verse 5, "Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria." He's one of those who was scattered, "and preached Christ to them." And preached Christ to them. That's the reason they're on fire with joy. And that, dear friend, is how you and I will find joy. There's no other legitimate, lasting means of joy than having Christ preach to us the fullness of his person, the invitation to believe on him, the experience of the forgiveness of sins, and the promise of eternal glory. Oh, that was burning in our bosom as it should be, as it could be. Because this city is filled with joy because the people there are conscious of God's grace and favour. It was always God's intention that the gospel would do this. Take yourself to that field where the shepherds are out watching the sheep the night the Saviour is born. We'll be singing all about it while shepherds watch their flocks by night, won't we, very soon? Let me read the scripture. Luke chapter 2, verse 10, "And the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you,'" bet you can fill it in, "good tidings of great joy." "I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people," not just the Jews, the Samaritans as well, "for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Saviour." You see how it goes on? But it doesn't finish there. The angel says, "Who is Christ the Lord?" Philip went down and preached Christ to them. Preached, well, that's not a very PC word nowadays, is it? You want to look at the empty seats. People don't like to be preached at, preached to. They don't like the idea that any individual should be able to stand up and speak for 40 minutes or thereabouts uninterrupted. Everybody wants to be heard, to have their say. And yet when you read your Bible, you can't get round the fact that the way of God in bringing joy to men and women is through having a preacher. The angel was the preacher to the shepherds, wasn't he? Philip was the preacher to the people in the city of Samaria. I hardly dare to claim to be the preacher here today, but that's what I'm trying to do. And therefore, there is the potential, is there not, for great joy. The word used here to preach is important. If you had read verse 4 with me, you'll see that it says they went everywhere preaching the word. And I explained to you last week that word preaching there is the word from which we get evangelism. They were evangelizing the word. They were just, well, I think it's J.B. Phillips who says, they were gossiping the gospel. This was every, I was going to say Tom, Dick and Harry, I don't mean to demean anybody. This was just everybody's business. But when you get to Philip, a new word is introduced. You don't see it in the English, but if you read the Greek, you would. The new word actually means to be a herald. And when you read the New Testament, that's one of the prominent emphases and themes about preaching. A preacher is like a town crier. They resurrect them, don't they, in our villages and towns because of the novelty. But back in the old days, even before me, the town crier was how you got your news. Today in the government we have announced that this is going to happen, your taxes are going to drop. That's good news. Today our armies have won a great battle and we're now free to live and raise our children. That's good news. That was the job of the herald, with his bell going out. That's the job of the preacher. To be like a herald, to express this wonderful truth that God has acted to fulfill his promises and is bringing about the kingdom of God. One last thing on the word preach. It's in what's called the imperfect tense in the text. And that actually means that he didn't just stand up once, but that he was preaching and preaching and preaching and preaching. Wherever he could find an audience, he would begin to tell the wonderful truth about the Lord Jesus Christ. This is God's ordained means of bringing joy to sinners. How shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? Romans 10:14. And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Now I'm not here to boost my status or position. It's an awesome responsibility. Nobody is to take this task on them lightly. It has to be weighed up and judged and assessed by the church and confirmed by the church. But when it has been, the function of the preacher is to obey Christ in the congregation of God's people and go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Philip was preaching Christ. Now, if you had managed to get along to Costa Coffee yesterday, you'd have had a good explanation of who the Christ is. But because not everybody was there, I'll just go over it again. Preached Christ. Who is Christ? Why Christ? What is Christ? For many people, it's just a swear word, isn't it? They bang their finger with a hammer and out it comes. But I believe that's the devil's ace tactic, isn't it? If you want people to ignore what a word means, make it so common and so insignificant that you can use it as a swear word. Let's not do that. Let's go back and recognize that Christ means anointed. It's the equivalent of the Old Testament Messiah. And it's the official title of our Lord Jesus Christ. 514 times in the New Testament. Now, I didn't go and count them, I'm trusting a book. 514 times. You're entitled. Go home today and count them if you want. Why is he called Christ? Because in the Old Testament, there were three individuals who were anointed. There was the priest. The one who made intercession between man and God. The one through whom your sins could be forgiven. There was the prophet. The one who brought you God's words and told you the way of life. And there was the king. In his coronation he was anointed with oil. And that was to signify the infilling of the Holy Spirit and the equipping and setting apart of the individual for to rule over God's people. So when Philip preached that Jesus is the Christ, he didn't just keep on going around saying, Jesus is the Christ, Jesus is the Christ, Jesus is the Christ. He would unpack it, surely. He's the one that God said to Adam and Eve was coming and who would crush Satan's head. He's the one that when Abraham couldn't find the sheep, I've got the wrong story, haven't I? When Abraham was brought into covenant and was told that one of his seed would come and bring God's word to the whole world. And that's why they're the mark of circumcision. He's the one that was promised to David when David was told, sinner as he was, that there would always be one of his descendants to sit on the throne. He's the one, you see, that is the story of the Old Testament. So when they go down to the city of Samaria, as it says in the text, they are preaching the coming and the fulfilling of God's promises. Now you remember who the Samaritans were? Let me just check the time. The Samaritans were sort of half Jews. And they were hated by the Jews because they weren't really Jewish. Way back in the Old Testament, when the people of Israel were taken out of the Promised Land, what happened was those who took them out brought people from other countries and put them into the land. When the people arrived in the country, they found, or they had this idea that gods were territorial. So they began to worship the God of the Jews who'd been taken away, but they didn't do it fully. Now, there's a lot more to the Samaritans than that. But they're sort of not really Jews. They don't have the right links to Abraham. And you'll find over and over, when they wanted to insult Jesus, they called him a Samaritan. But the gospel was to go to the whole world. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witness to me in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. But they've got stuck in Jerusalem. So this persecution comes, and out they go. Philip finds himself in Samaria, so he begins to preach Christ. The Samaritans didn't believe all the Old Testament. They only had the first five books of the Old Testament. But in that, they believed that Messiah was coming. They had Deuteronomy 18:15, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst, from your brethren, him you shall hear. And that's what Philip spoke. Notice, because I stopped at the end of verse 5, didn't I? Verse 6 goes on, and the multitudes, with one accord, heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. As he preached Christ, God changed their hearts, and there was a multitude. How many is in a multitude? I have no idea. There's going to be a multitude in heaven, isn't there? Which no man can number, and that's the idea of a multitude. There was a revival took place in Samaria. And that's why the city was filled with great joy. Jesus had preached to the Samaritans. I've run out of time. I wanted to go back to John 4, but I'll leave you to read that yourself. And one of the things that the woman at the well, when she goes to speak to her neighbor, said is, could this be the Christ? And many Samaritans believed on him back then. Now Philip comes down and says she was right. And because she was right, God looks upon you with grace and favor. Your sins can be forgiven. If you will come and bow the knee to Jesus, you'll become a new creature and you'll have an inheritance reserved in heaven for you. You begin to see where the joy is coming from, don't you? You begin to see why these people would be excited as they were. And down through history, this has happened. At this point, I always want to bring up an instance of revival, and I'm aware that there's one or two in the church interested in the history of the Civil War in the United States. I came across this. Revivals in the Union and Confederate armies in the early 1860s. In the Union Army, between 100,000 and 200,000 soldiers were converted. Among Confederate forces, approximately 150,000 troops converted to Christ. Sometimes preaching and praying continued 24 hours a day, and chapels couldn't hold the soldiers that wanted to get inside. Do you think that would have been a source of great joy? Do you think that would have meant dear friends, I long for days like that again, and I pray that you would. And if I want this joy in my own life, I know where to go to find it. I need to get back to being enraptured, captured, revived in love towards my Saviour because of his love for me. And when it sets my soul on fire, maybe it will set somebody else's on fire in the last 4 minutes. How did this come there? By the lips of a preacher. He preached Christ to them, but it was a man that did it. This always intrigues me. You see, when God set out to bring about the redemption of people, he took human form. And that's the joy of Christmas, isn't it? One of the hymn writers says, God confined to a span. Lovely picture. And we delight in this great truth that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to us. But the great truth that goes on from that is that he didn't stop after Jesus came. What he decided was that men and women would encounter God in other men and women. You can hardly imagine Philip's circumstances. In chapter 21, he has two daughters. He's clearly one of the Hellenist Jews that's being hunted out of the city. He's running for his life. He's got bairns to look after. He would have had every reason in the world to keep running. But his heart is so full of Christ himself, the wonder of God's love, that when he gets to somewhere he can have an audience, out it comes. God speaks to people through people. Now, many of us find that very difficult because we like to imagine we're too shy or something else, but the fact is you're always speaking whether your mouth's open or not. We're books read and known by men, is what my Bible says. And it just makes sense at times when the door opens to open your mouth. You don't have to give everybody the whole detail of the gospel. But just to drop a seed here, a seed there. Because you realise there's only one way to heaven, and that's through Christ. I was speaking to the JWs and Pickering yesterday, and they said to me, why do you keep coming here? You've got your view, we've got ours, we disagree, we're never going to agree. I said, quite simply, I said, it's because I care. I believe you're deceived. I believe you're going to eternal hell. Didn't go down well. But that's why we speak. That's why Philip is speaking. I don't always do it. I flounder at the most stupid times. But if you come back to base, that's what it's about. God speaks to people through people. God speaks to people through preaching. These words in Corinthians 1:21. For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through, listen to this, the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign and Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews a stumbling block and to the Greeks foolishness. Now here it is, the bottom line, but to those who are called, my sheep hear my voice. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Oh my dear friends, that you and I would be captured again by the wonder of the gospel, because that's what the world is looking for. It's tired of religion. It's tired even of Christianity. They need to catch the fire. And if they're going to catch the fire from me, I need to be on fire. When George Whitefield was about preaching, a man was going to hear him preach at 5 o'clock in the morning, and the philosopher and skeptic David Hume was found walking along the street to go and hear him. And so he said to him, I thought you didn't believe the gospel. And Mr. Hume replied, I don't, but he does. I don't, but he does. That's the key to joy. That's the key to joy, because this world is on a disaster course. Left to itself, the broad road leads to destruction. Philip, help me. Show me afresh what it was that took you when you were running for your life and then used you to bring about the salvation of these people in Samaria. You might not be a preacher like I am, but you can pray for us. Paul says, pray that I might have the words. Ephesians chapter 6, isn't it? And that's why you and I can work together. You might not have enough knowledge to go and talk to the JWs, but pray for those of us who will. Be involved. Not because you need to pray, but because this is how the gospel sets the world on fire. This is the key to great joy. Come on, you must want it. The day as well, these buildings are full. And you have to come early to get a good seat. Now you can have whichever one you want, almost. Is it going to change? Well, one of the key factors in revival is that when God is about to change the temperature of joy, he gets people praying. Make it a central factor in your prayer meeting, that the glory of God shall be revealed. Let me finish. The comedian Lenny Bruce, I don't really know him, I know the name, once said life was like this. Look, you only have 65 years to live. Before you're 20, you can't enjoy anything because you don't know what's going on. After you're 50, you can't enjoy it either because you don't have the physical energies. So you only have around 25 years and I'm going to swing. Apparently, he died of an overdose of morphine at the age of 40. That's miserable. And that's what the would-be comedians of this world, the prophets of the present age, are sharing. We've got good news. And I pray that the good news has got us.